Let's just start with what we know from the biblical text and from Assyrian documentation as well. So it seems there were three major periods of deportation in the late 8th century. The first was under Tiglath-Pileser III, known in Tanakh, in the Hebrew scriptures, as King Pul. And this was in the 730s. Records indicate, in a few different places when you add them up, something like 13,250 Jews were taken from the northern part of the land of Israel. Those of you who are watching this video without watching previous ones will know that I tend to use the term Jews anachronistically. Just forgive me for it. Most Jews do that. At any rate, about 13,250 exiles, appears that all of them were males, were taken from the northern region. It appears also that Jews had some experience, as we saw in the last lecture, in the military field in particular. They may have excelled in, especially in charioteering, and it could be that, just supposition, that perhaps he took some men of military age over families and things like that. Then we have a second period under Shalmaneser V and his son Sargon. Shalmaneser is on the left, and the figure on the right is believed to be Sargon II. We have a much more specific number from their records of 27,280, or elsewhere 27,290, and this occurred in the year 722 through 720, and would have affected the area around Samaria itself. This is a really hard specific number that feels a lot more real than a lot of the numbers that you see in some of these documents. And then finally, you have King Sennacherib in Hebrew, or Sennacherib in English, who claims to have removed 200,000 Jews, a very, very large number, from the region of Judah at the very end of the 8th century. We'll talk more about that two lectures from now. At any rate, these are the three major deportations that we're speaking about. It is interesting to note that the evidence from the biblical text and also from ostraca that are discovered in the region where they were resettled suggests that the Jews who were taken away were not in fact enslaved, but nevertheless they were forcibly required to remain in these places. And well, let's continue the story from there. So what exactly happened to them? Again, based on the biblical text and a few little bits of pieces in other sources, we see that the Jews from the kingdom of Israel itself, that is the 10 northern tribes, were sent off to these three locations: Hamath, which is somewhere in northern Lebanon, western Syria; the region of Gozan and nearby river, which, as you can see, is the middle circle here; and then finally out to the newly conquered region of the Assyrian Empire in Media. What happened to the Jews when they got there? So we have scattered onomastic evidence, which I love these words. Onomastic means proper names, meaning we see evidence of people with Semitic and sometimes definitively Hebrew names, especially because of the theophoric nature of many Hebrew names. Theophoric is another good word. It means like it involves the name of God, like Jews like including the name of God in their children's names. Several of my children have one of the several names of God built into their names itself. Like, for example, the common name Michael, not the name of one of my kids, but means Michael, which is who is like God, right? So it's very common to have a name like that. Or Kal-El, for example, Clark Kent. So when you look at some of the ostraca that are discovered, such as this one discovered in the city of Nimrud, dating from the late 7th century, often the texts are in Aramaic, very rarely in Hebrew, and there's clearly some Hebrew names, or at least Semitic names, included in there. Just little bits of pieces of what this might mean. Sometimes these ostraca indicate that there are Jews there, or potential Jews, who were active as charioteers. As I mentioned earlier, there seems to have been some history of Jews involved in that particular aspect of the military. There's one possible Jew who was named as a village manager, again, supporting the idea that they were hardly enslaved when they were out there, that they had the possibility of rising to positions of administrative authority. And one especially fascinating passage that refers to a Hosea, very Jewish name, who redeems a woman named Dina from slavery, right? Paying a ransom for him. This is especially interesting because there is a very long-standing tradition of redeeming captives as a high-value mitzvah or a commandment that devolves upon Jews that basically says that you have to drop everything to try and redeem someone from slavery. At any rate, these are kind of like just little bits and pieces that suggest that, yes, the story has historic validity. Jews were living in these regions, that the biblical text and the Assyrian documentation coincides. But unfortunately, we don't know a lot about what exactly happened to them. If we look at the map with contemporary political boundaries overlaid, we see that these exiles would have been settled in northern Lebanon, southern Syria, which is not terribly far away from Israel. It's easily conceivable that they could have migrated back over centuries. We see them on the border of Turkey and Syria, perhaps in the Kurdish regions, and we see them out in western Iran as well. So most historians assume that the vast majority of these exiles simply assimilated into the larger populations in which they lived. This is actually a very common element of Jewish history, particularly in the diaspora, where Jews over a period of generations simply lose their attachment to their ancestral peoplehood and simply blend in with the populations around them. There are some very significant exceptions, and when we get a little further on in this class and we start talking about the post-Roman exile after the first Roman-Jewish war, and especially after the Bar Kochba rebellion, Jews began to develop actual social strategies to maintain their group integrity, which stood them very well over the next 2,000 years, preserving their integrity as a social group, but not perfectly. So, and by the way, going backwards in time, there is a long-standing midrash that says that 80% of the Jews living in Egypt chose not to leave with the Exodus. That is, only 20% of the population actually took Moses up on his word and followed him out into the desert and ultimately into Israel. So the story of Jewish assimilation into the background population is very common and very plausible. However, this rabbit hole goes really deep, and I don't want to take it very far in this particular lecture, but I hope to return to it several times as we go through the entire saga of the Jewish history, because the legend of the 10 lost tribes has been a dominant motivating idea that you see in all kinds of Jewish movements. For example, the movement of the 20th century Hasidic Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, shown here, who is one of the greatest leaders of the Chabad movement, and in reality, one of the greatest leaders of the Jewish people in modern times, who mounted several campaigns specifically to find assimilated Jews and also to reach out to non-Jews and to educate them, at the very least, in their connection to the Noahide commandments, and possibly to uncover people who wanted to convert, although that was never an explicit goal because, after all, Judaism is not a proselytizing religion, with one significant exception that we'll get to in about four or five lectures from now. At any rate, they're based very heavily on this idea in Hebrew of the kibbutz galuyos, the gathering together of the exiles, which you find several times in the biblical text. I give you one verse here from the book of Ezekiel, Yechezkel. I will take the children of Israel, right? Notably, the B'nai Israel is the Hebrew term used there, but it has that feeling of the northern kingdom as well, from among the nations where they have gone, and I will bring them from all around and return them to their land. This idea of the ingathering of the exiles is a very powerful notion that runs its way through Jewish civilization to the present day. We see it also in the secular Zionist movement, headed perhaps most famously by Theodor Herzl, shown in this postcard, which has written in Hebrew and then in German and then in French the phrase, "If you will it, it is no dream," meaning if you want to all come back to Israel and create a state there. Of course, this was stated before Israel as a modern entity became a reality in 1948. You know, then you have this image of this angelic creature breaking the chains, and with the flag emblazoned with the Star of David, gathering in all of these tired, oppressed, hungry masses to the land of Israel. This is something that really comes essentially from the legends of the 10 lost tribes. Now, what did people think of it in the ancient period? We see the assertion of socially intact tribes in many sources around the first century before the Common Era and the first century in the Common Era. Josephus and Paul and James in the Christian scriptures are especially noteworthy for their adherence to the idea that the 10 tribes still exist. Again, this would be 700 years later after the exile, in their units, that they actually still maintain their tribal identities in Iran and Iraq and so on. Rabbi Eliezer, of course, in the more mainstream Jewish tradition, also held that the 10 lost tribes are still there, intact and waiting. Other opinions, however, and this is typical of the Talmud, that you will have multiple opinions. The very famous and very authoritative Rabbi Akiva says the 10 tribes are not coming back. He argued that once they were taken away, they assimilated into the nations beyond them, and they are not going to be pulled out, certainly not in their tribal units. You'll see that in the Mishnah. There is also a discussion in the Jerusalem Talmud, again, more when we get later on in the series as to what is the Jerusalem as opposed to the Babylonian Talmud, that discusses this amazing river Sambation, which was apparently a river that was impassable during the 6 days of the week because it had all these rolling rocks that would run through the ravine rather than water, and it was impossible to cross safely. But on the Sabbath, this mystical river Sambation would suddenly rest, but because of the laws of traveling on the Sabbath, the Jews, the 10 tribes, would not be able to cross it and make their way back to Israel. Fascinating kind of things. What I will just mention here now is one of the many, literally dozens, of theories that developed over the next few millennia as to who the 10 lost tribes are. Who did they become? So for one example, let's just one of many, really. You have them in Japan, you have them in England, in Africa, all kinds of places. There's a testimony of a crypto-Jewish traveler named Antonio de Montesinos, who was Portuguese and who had outwardly accepted Catholicism in the context of the Inquisition, and like many of his socioeconomic and religious class, left Portugal to travel the world and look for a safer haven. He came to Ecuador, and then amazingly, as he recounted when he came back, he was greeted by the native population there with the Shema prayer. Right, hear, O Israel, Lord our God, the Lord is one. Astounding. And he believed that he had come across the 10 tribes that had relocated to far off Ecuador. There were other signs as well. They gave him Jewish food like chicken soup and egg rolls. No, I made that part up, but I couldn't help it. I haven't had lunch yet. And he came back to Amsterdam, and he reported this to a very important rabbi, Manasseh ben Israel, who was so taken with the idea that he wrote a book. It was translated into English ultimately as The Hope of Israel, Mikveh Yisrael, in which he argued that, you know, the country of England should readmit the Jews because we are now in the flourishing of the Messianic period, when the 10 lost tribes are being discovered. This was central to the thesis. And it created quite a stir, especially when it was translated into English. And many other works were produced that supported it, such as this interesting one here that I find especially interesting. Jews in America, or probabilities that those Indians are Judaical, made more probable by some additionals to the former conjectures. You know, an argument that the Native Americans are in fact the 10 lost tribes. One of many, many theories as to what became of the 10 lost tribes. Okay, I really intend to come back to this topic later on in this series because it actually plays an important role in many significant, especially pseudo-messianic movements throughout Jewish history. But for the time being, I want to thank you very much for watching. The next video will look at the origins of the Samaritans in Israel. Thanks again for watching.